morning and welcome to Mornings with Luann and Tim on Hump Day Wednesday. Woohoo!
We got stockings.
Yes, we do.
Stockings are hung by our window with care.
I hope they don't catch fire from that
from the candle.
Poof! Yeah, that would make
That's something to be very careful of at Christmas time. Don't use extension cords and no open flames.
Yes, be very, very
Look
careful.
Look at us getting all like, the police.
Don't say us, you.
Look at me. I get bonus points from our friends at the Sault Ste. Marie Fire Service.
Yes, you too.
What's going on?
Did you hear about Time Magazine's cover of the year?
Well, I did.
And it's very interesting because the editor-in-chief was interviewed and talked about how it's actually the first time that a person who has passed away is on the cover of Time Magazine.
So
the Khashoggi, the reporter Khashoggi, because he says it's unsubstantiated, or no, not unsubstantiated, it's unusual how much attention he has gotten after his death. So that's why they put his, amongst others, because they do several.
So there you go. Yeah, you can see it. So all of those
journalists.
Yeah, the cover is dedicated to the journalists who've lost their lives.
Mm-hmm.
In covering the news.
And
what?
Trying to get things done, yeah.
And what's interesting is that Trump thought for sure it was going to be him. He was gunning for it. He wanted to be Time Man of the Year.
You kidding me?
No, Trump was sure. He was talking about, oh yeah, it's got to be me. And then there was somebody else too.
What?
Oh no, he figured he had it all sewn up as Time Man of the Year. And now it turns out, look who it is.
And now he's going to have another temper tantrum. Thanks, Time. That's awesome. I don't get my wall, I'm shutting the government down.
Oh, that was awful to watch. That was ridiculous.
What?
Two adults and Donald Trump sitting in the Oval Office.
Chuck Schumer and Nancy Pelosi having a discussion, or trying to, and Chuck Schumer and Nancy Pelosi, to their credit, stayed very professional.
Didn't back down.
And then Chuck said to, Chuck like I know him, said to Trump, okay, you're saying it. We are not putting words in your mouth. You are saying it. So you are saying, if you don't get your wall funded, you're going to shut down the government. Trudeau.
Trump said,
absolutely. If I don't get the wall, the government is going to be shut down.
I will take the mantle, he said. And I won't blame you. He said that.
I won't blame you.
Well, I won't blame you if I have to shut the government down. It's all
on
me.
You know what, though? Problem is, as Nancy Pelosi tried to remind the president, first of all, it's a law. Secondly, Congress is going to outnumber you, so it's not going to happen. As she tried to explain to him logistically, logically, okay, you don't have enough votes for this. If I need votes, I'll get votes.
He said, I can't get votes in this. He said, so, first of all, it has to go to the House, and then it goes to the Senate, right?
Yeah.
He said, well, I need 10 Democrat senators in order to pass this in the Senate. And unless I can get those 10 Democrat senators, there's no point in even bringing the bill to the Senate. And she said, but first it's got to pass the House. And he says, I can pass the House. It'll pass the House. And she said, Mr. President, it's not going to pass the House. I'm telling you right now, you're not going to get a bipartisan vote on this bill. There aren't enough Republicans to get it through. No, I'll pass the House. She said, then try.
Yeah.
No, I'm not going to try because I don't need to try because it's just going to get stopped.
It's going to happen.
It's going to get stopped at the Senate anyway. The Senate's going to stop it, and then I'm going to have to shut the government down.
It has to get to the Senate first, Mr. President.
And she just kept saying that. Like, put it to a vote in the House. We're going to show you. If you would allow us to put it to a vote in the House, we will show you that the majority of the representatives of the citizens of this country don't want your wall. He won't do it because he knows.
You know, and like right in front of the cameras.
Oh, it was embarrassing.
It was like a sandbox. It was like I was waiting for somebody to chuck something at somebody.
She kept saying, can we please not do this here
in public?
In public?
Yeah.
And he's like, no, we're all friends here.
Let's do this. You know what? She's sort of in a tentative position because some people are saying that she should no longer be the leader of the Democrats. I'll tell you something. She's smart. She never falters. She's always classy.
Mm-hmm. And she knows her stuff.
She knows exactly what's going on.
And then she said to him, you know, this is not right to sit here and you're using false information on those cards. The information you have on those cards, you're waving in our faces about who's getting into the country, the illegals, and they have drugs and they have weapons and they're bad, bad people. She said, you're waving these cards and it's misinformation, and we're not going to do this. We're not going to sit here and argue this when you're not talking facts. She said that in the Oval Office.
Now, someone else might have said, you're a liar. But that's what I mean. She succinctly, businesslike,
yeah,
put it to him and said, listen,
we're not,
you can pretend that nobody knows what you're doing, but we see you.
And then he said, he mentioned her precarious position.
Yeah.
And she said, you know what? Don't go there. Don't diminish my capacity
as of now.
Right.
You know what, though? Let's talk about your precarious position, Mr. President.
So.
Might be the first president who will go to jail after his tenure. Let's talk about that.
I just keep thinking they're talking about what's going to happen in 2020. I'm thinking, if he's still around in 2020, what are we going to
do? Oh, my gosh.
Please don't tell me. Please don't tell me. We have to do another year and a half, 2 years with this.
Oh, another 2 years.
Oh, my gosh.
Yep.
It's poinsettia day to lighten
awesome.
The mood a little bit.
Yay.
We're getting into the holiday. Trina's decorated for us here. And so I didn't bring a poinsettia in. There's
the
flower.
I have a story.
What about a poinsettia?
Yes.
Well, go. Tell me. I don't know this.
So my father had a lot of physical challenges prior to his death for the last 25 years or so. And he had a chair. You know, one of those ones you press the button and the chair lifts
yes.
up?
Yes. Oh, yes.
So my former co-host, Scott Turnbull,
yes.
from KISS 100.5, had surgery. And he was looking at renting one. My dad passed away almost 9 years ago now. So my mom said, well, just give it to him. Just
let him
use
had
it.
The chair.
Yeah, so she
in
still
Espinoodle.
Had the chair. Yeah, so he went to Espinoodle and he got the chair and used
Scott
it.
Drove there.
Loved the chair. He said, oh my gosh, this chair. Because you can't like pull yourself up because you're going to split and all that stuff, eh?
Open heart surgery.
Right. So this was just prior to Christmas last year, maybe December, definitely the end of November. So to say thank you, his wife Liz brought me a poinsettia. The poinsettia all year never died.
Really?
Never died. It sat on a little garden stool in front of my French doors and my kitchen window. It never, ever died.
It bloomed all year long.
It didn't bloom.
Oh.
But the leaves kept growing and
really?
They'd fall off and others would keep.
No
yeah,
kidding.
And now it's turning red.
Right? Well, here's what I didn't know. The name of it.
Mm-hmm.
It's named after the first ambassador to Mexico.
Huh?
Okay, so his name was Joel Roberts Poinsett, P-O-I-N-S-E-T-T. He died. The reason this is Poinsettia Day is because he died on this date in 1851.
Oh.
December the 12th. He was the first ambassador to Mexico. He saw the plant. He brought it back to his plantation in Greenville, South Carolina.
Wow.
And began growing the plants and gave them away as Christmas gifts to friends. Because he just thought they were beautiful. But in Mexico, that's where they're originally from.
Yes, I didn't realize that.
The name is Flor de Nochebuena, so which means Christmas Eve flower.
So, do you say poinsettia or poinsettia?
Poinsettia. I say, look at that. Thank you. That's Joel Robert Poinsett. Now, I say poinsettia, but it is spelled P-O-I-N-S-E-T-T-I-A, poinsettia.
It is.
How do you say
it? I say poinsettia.
So I don't know he was poinsett and they call it poinsettia. I don't
yeah,
understand
some
what
people, and some people, like one or the other, insist that's the right way to do it.
Yeah.
So just say the red flower.
There you go. Or the flor de Nochebuena.
Yeah.
If you want to be fancy.
That.
Flor de Nochebuena.
Nochebuena.
That's buena.
I can hardly do English this morning, so.
Can't speak Spanish.
No.
Another plant that grows now in Canada. Cannabis.
Cannabis.
Timmins.
Yes.
There's a restaurant owner in Timmins. Her name is Brianna Humphrey. And Brianna is going to launch an online cooking with cannabis show. She's going to go through, like, I think she's going to do it through Shaw up in Timmins.
So some hash brownies in your future if you need them.
Cannabis, and she says one of the first things she's going to teach people how to do is make cannabis infused butter, and then you can use that butter to bake your cookies and stuff with.
Oh my word!
And so what she says is the benefits of this are that it gives you it. You know, rather than getting like a buzz,
stoned,
your body relaxes and you get a body buzz kind of thing, and so it's good for sleep, good for rest, good for relaxation.
Well, you know what? I read that there's all kinds of different kinds of cannabis.
Well, I'm sure there
are. And some are body stones and some are like just headstones.
Less talking like headstones.
You know what I mean? Like, so.
Oh, headstone. That's like a graveyard.
Yeah.
I don't want to smoke cannabis and end up with a headstone.
No, thank you very much. But you know what?
That's what happens if you smoke cannabis and drive. You end up with a headstone.
Yes.
Don't
drive.
Token drive.
Don't.
Don't do it.
But I think that's probably a really, it's going to be a really popular TV show. You think?
Good for her.
Infused butter. Use cannabis.
You. So what you do, you want to hear this little story?
Yeah,
she does it. She takes because cannabis, apparently the cannabis oil will adhere to anything that's fatty. So you take the cannabis, you put it in your butter, and you put it in a mason jar, and you seal it, and you put it in a slow cooker in water, and it heats up. The butter melts. It infuses the butter with the cannabis,
like
and
the
then
infused oil.
Mm-hmm, and then you drain the butter back out, so there's no chunks of cannabis in it, but it's got all of the. And then you use that butter for baking. Isn't that clever? We're already out of time. This banter went fast.
Gosh, you just went on and on, didn't you?
It's Wellness Wednesday, so stay with us. We have two guests talking about wellness today, and Luann has the news. So lots coming up on Mornings with Luann and Tim. We'll be right back after this. Welcome back to Mornings with Luann and Tim and Judith Onley. Judith Onley, who is now one of our featured, what would you call yourself? A host on TV.
Yeah.
She has her own show. Do I get any kind of commission or anything for this?
I don't know. How's that work, Tim?
So Judith and I met through, we've known each other for a number of years, but you were on the show as a guest.
Yes.
And then you discovered that this was a great sort of medium for you to share your message, and it's really worked out well, hasn't it?
It really has, and it's kind of a little bit surreal still for me. Brand new medium, and
right?
You know, for you, it's old hand for you, because you're so used to always being in front of people or lights or camera or...
Do you know that Michael just told us we've had about 150 episodes, I think, just recently for the morning show.
Wow.
Yeah. How many episodes have you taped so far?
Five.
Five of how many?
Of 10.
So you're halfway there.
Halfway there.
Tell me about the experience. How have you taken... Let's first of all talk about the books, all
mm-hmm.
right? So just so the audience knows that Judith is an author. Two books,
yes.
Right? Tell me a little bit about the books, Judith, so for people who didn't see the first interview.
Well, this particular show is based on my book, Messages of Hope, and I'm sorry, I forgot to bring it in with us.
Oh, I have a copy in the office still.
I a little bit rushed this morning, but we're good. And it is channeled messages from beings, non-physical beings that I connect with to bring through words and wisdom.
Us.
Us. It's
called, stands for?
United Souls of Heaven and Earth. And non-physical beings, a consciousness that comes through me, and they're lovely, beautiful, empowering, inspiring words. And so I published that book a year ago, and it hit best-selling author.
And that's fantastic.
It's awesome. And then my first book, which was published in 2011, is called Your Mastery, Live It Now. And it also when we kind of republished it last year, it also hit best-selling author. So it's a wonderful experience, because I just whatever happens with the books or the show or anything else that I do, I know this is my mission.
And the messaging is I don't know how I could phrase it. Let's see, enlightening. It makes me feel comfort. Is that a good way of putting it?
Absolutely. That's.
I think sort of when you talk about the universe and how we're specks, and there's so much energy out there.
Yeah.
And it's about tapping into that and just allowing yourself to be, really.
Yes.
Freeing yourself up of so much of this baggage that we carry, and when you really do that, when you really let go and let everything just channel through you, there's a huge release.
Absolutely.
And. So for me, reading the messages, you have a smaller version of the books, the highlights, the tips.
Yes.
When I look at those messages, it's almost like those little messages of the day kind of thing. They just allow you to kind of clear your thoughts and experience the moment and go, why? I can't deal with most of this stuff, so why am I worrying about it? Let the universe take care of itself.
That's it. Absolutely it. And I tell people all the time, they kind of laugh at me, I read my own book. Well, you know, I channeled it, I wrote it, all of that, and I still pick it up and, you know, I open a page and you know, read a word or a paragraph or something, go, okay, I just need to remember that. It's about remembering who we really are, Tim. You know, could be a teacher or, you know, a host or a ditch digger. It doesn't matter what we are in our roles in life, but it's how we bring ourselves to those roles that really makes a difference, not just for ourselves, but for the people that we connect with. So that's one of my missions, is when I can help somebody to feel that inner peace or to, you know, the acceptance and honoring of themselves and know that they are magnificent and wonderful and here to, you know, shine light. I talk about that in every episode. I end it with, you know, keep on shining. So, you know, when you walk into a room with somebody who's really knows who they are and they're feeling good and exuding joy and emanating their light, then you want to be around them.
The other thing I really appreciate about what the book teaches is that it's about love.
Yes.
Living with love. The idea of approaching every human being, every other person, with love, instead of approaching somebody out of anger or resentment or any of those negative...
Or judgment.
When you turn that around and you actually approach that person with love, it changes everything.
One of the chapters in the book actually is called Just Love. Mm-hmm. And I've had that experience so many times of, you know, we get upset with people and things. And then if you just say those words to yourself, just love, your whole energy changes.
I don't want to sort of confuse people with this being more of a philosophy, like more of a psychological thing. However, it's almost like in psychology, or I guess in like psychologists or psychiatrists would say, what's that called when you have to teach yourself how to do something? Oh, I'm trying to think of the word. Cognitive behavioral therapy.
Yeah.
It's not the same, but the concept is changing the way you think.
Yes.
To improve your reaction to different scenarios. I'm sorry it took me so long to get there. I need another cup of coffee. But you know what I'm saying?
It's really changing your old programs that are not serving you anymore. Those conditions that we've been told that you're not good enough, you're not worthy, you're not smart enough, all of those. When we tap in, Tim, to that, I call it our divine essence, mm-hmm. then we're perfect and we're divine. And when we operate from that place and we see others as that, all the other stuff drops away.
Tell me, Judith, now the show's premiering a week from today.
Yes.
On TV. On TV. Well, I mean, if you're seeing us now, you know how to find it. But do you have a time slot yet?
Yes, it's 12:30.
12:30 in the afternoon.
In the afternoon. And then it repeats again at 8:30.
That's a good time of night.
Well,
people are sitting
times,
down, relaxing.
Yeah, so maybe someone could zip in and look at it on their lunch hour, or they could, you know, see it in the evening. And then I guess the reruns are actually going to run on Saturdays and Sundays, 12:30, 6:30, and 12:30 again. So for all you Nighthawks out there.
What your messages from the book, how is that translating to television episodes? Are you finding that difficult, or have you figured it out now?
I have made this script that I am really proud of. I've got a template going that we talk about, you know, what the book, why we're doing the show. I talk about we do a meditation in it. I give a little home assignment so that we can continue
on. So every episode is like almost like a chapter?
A chapter with a lesson and that you take away.
Fascinating.
I know.
So you can watch and learn and on your own time, too.
On your own time.
Because it's going to be on YouTube, too. It'll be on our View on Demand channel as well.
Yes, it will.
And then you're going to have a whole box set to put together.
Yes, I love it.
So Judith Onley, and your show is called Messages of Hope.
Messages of Hope.
And it premieres Wednesday December the 19th.
Yeah.
12:30 in the afternoon, 8:30 at night.
Night, yeah.
And then we'll be available on View on Demand as well.
Absolutely.
Thanks for coming in this morning.
Well, thank you, Tim. I am just so thrilled to be part of all of this and have a whole new medium.
It's fantastic. It's fantastic. We look forward to seeing the show.
Thank you, Tim.
And you'll come back on again and we'll talk about how things are going.
How it's going.
Absolutely.
And we'll come
back with Luann to chat a little bit more on Mornings with what's the show called? Mornings with Luann and Tim. Right after this. More coffee.
Thank you, Tim.
Better watch out. You better not cry. Better not pout. I'm telling you why. Santa Claus is coming to town. He's making a list, checking it twice. He's gonna find out who's naughty and nice.
Santa Claus is coming to town. Hey, I'm swinging it. Ooh, Baby It's Cold Outside is back on CBC.
What?
Yes, the song Baby It's Cold Outside is no longer banned on CBC. They brought it back again because of public reaction.
Mm-hmm. Really?
Yep, saying let's take it at face value, what it was in, 72 years ago when it was written.
Right.
And also, somebody said, you know, one of the lyrics, I was talking about the lyric about, hey, what's in this drink? There's another lyric about where she says, I ought to say no and at least look like I said that I tried. And it's like, it's about as much about shaming the woman as it is about the guy kind of thing.
They're flirting.
It's a playful thing, and that's what they're saying. It's a playful thing.
She doesn't want her to go home because it's all nice and cozy.
And she doesn't really want to go either, is what they're saying.
But she's scared of what the neighbors are going to say.
Right.
Because, you know, women have to worry about their reputations. Not you, man. No, no, no.
Oh, here we go. So maybe you should take it off the air again. Luann's upset now. Anyway, Baby's Cold Outside is back on CBC. There you go.
Way to go. Way to be brave, CBC. Regardless of how you feel about it, that's a brave thing to do.
Oh, well.
The Oscars, we know there's no host. So yesterday I was telling you how they were thinking of just leaving it like that. Have no host, per se, and just bring some people in to do different presentations. Whoopi Goldberg now has come forward apparently and said, yeah, if they asked, I'd do it.
She said she'd do it again.
Yeah, she said, I would do it. I don't think she's officially been approached, but she said that on the air on her show.
Why wouldn't they?
Right? She's so hilarious. And
remember her coming out as the queen? With
yes. Oh my gosh, she was so funny. Speaking of Oscars, though, Leonardo DiCaprio took years and years and years and years. He was becoming a meme, actually, to get an Oscar.
He never won.
2015, he won for The Revenant.
Okay.
Finally.
I saw that movie.
Yes. Did you? Was it good?
Yes. It was long.
It was, eh?
Yes.
That's the one with the
long and him cold a lot.
Oh, burn.
He went through a lot in that movie. I remember watching the movie going,
I hear that.
Why is that character still alive?
Yeah, seriously,
anyway,
right?
Yeah, anyway.
So anyway, he's got his Oscar finally, but the federal government is after him because they want the Oscar back.
Why?
But it's not that Oscar. So listen to this.
I'm so confused.
Now, this is where you got to know the right kind of people.
Okay.
There's this Malaysian financier. His name is Joe Low. And he bought...
When they go high, we go low.
That's right. He bought Marlon Brando's Oscar for On the Waterfront.
At an auction.
He bought it for $600,000.
Okay.
And got to know Leo. And gave it to him as a present. Imagine.
You can't do that.
Marlon Brando, On the Waterfront, his Oscar is your present. Well, apparently, Jolo should have gone high.
Oh.
Because the feds are after him because they suspect investment fraud on his behalf for billions of dollars.
So you mean the money that he used to buy the Oscar was probably illegal money,
so therefore the purchase is
not even really legal
because
it was
legit.
Stolen funds.
I wonder who's going to get Marlon's Oscar.
Maybe it'll be that lady he sent up who was a fake First Nations lady to say that he wouldn't accept his award.
Maybe it'll be in my stocking.
Do you want an Academy Award?
Yeah, I'd love one.
Okay, I'll see what I can do.
Yeah, Marlon's though.
I'll call Jolo.
Jolo, yeah. Could you imagine? Billions of dollars.
Wow.
So there's Leo. I thought you were my friend. I'm here.
But he still gets to keep the money earned for the revenue.
Sure, because absolutely.
Because he was very cold and wet for a lot of that film, and I think that's why they gave it to him. He's like, poor Leo.
He had pruny toes.
He was cold and wet for
yeah,
that.
Yeah, his feet were like...
It was like having a tangerine in your sock.
Yeah, right? Except it didn't stink so much because you were so cold. He had like raisin toes.
Did you already count us down?
Yes, he did.
I want to talk about the fact that the Grammy Awards are going to be at Madison Square Garden. 50,000 capacity. 50,000 screaming fans. It's going to be quite the...
You just talked about it.
I did. Good for me.
Good
okay,
for you.
What happens next?
Now we're going to go to our newscast, and we have more Wellness Wednesday coming up on Mornings with Luann and Tim. Thanks for watching.
So I'm just saying, if Timmins is going to have an online cannabis cooking show, and Sudbury City Council has now said yes to retail cannabis stores in Sudbury as early as April 2019, what's the decision we have to make at our city council level? Just do it.
They just want some more information. It's coming right at
the
beginning.
Get off the pot.
You said that whole thing just so you could say that.
No, that just popped into my head because I'm clever.
Oh, is that why?
That's why.
You have to keep reminding me of these things.
That I'm clever.
That you're clever. They're working on it, though.
Yeah.
Yeah, the mayor brought it to the staff.
When do they vote?
Just after Christmas.
Okay.
Yeah.
Why not?
Very beginning of January.
They got to do more research?
Yes, they want numbers. Some of the people want some numbers as to, you know.
Like how many grams?
Well, like.
What numbers do they want?
Well, no, but like how many stores can you have? Where can the stores go? How big do the stores have to be?
How many stores can you have?
Yeah.
I don't understand that part, but I mean, it's a business. Well, you don't say how many Max Marts can you have? Do we say that? Do we limit that? If you're a business person and you want to invest and be an entrepreneur and open a store, how do you say
that's a good point?
That's the maximum. Just because it's a legal substance. I don't get
but
it.
But it's how a regulated legal substance.
Yeah, so it depends.
Like we have liquor stores, of course.
Yes,
but
we
if
do.
You have a liquor store here, you're not going to have another liquor store there. So they just want to know details like that.
Okay.
Like who can own it, obviously not who can go in, but like what's the market like?
Liquor stores are licensed by the, okay.
By
so
the
who
province.
Who licenses the cannabis stores? The province?
Yes.
Okay.
So they just want more information.
But if the
it's good to make informed information on decisions.
All I'm saying is if the province is the one who decides how many licenses can be given out.
Call
then,
Doug.
Then why? Oh, for crying in the wilderness.
Right?
Then what? Well, I mean, you know what? If he could have had a storefront back when he was in high school, he wouldn't have had to sell hash illegally in high school. He could have done it up and up and on the up and
he
up.
He might still be there.
Mm. He needs to go back to high school and get a sex education to find out the difference between sex and gender. Anyway, that's neither here nor there.
It went right over there.
That stupid clip of that guy McVitie or whatever his name is, that evangelical, and he's hanging out with them, and this is the guy that says, oh no, we don't want to confuse our children with sex education. Why did you get me there? Did I go there?
You went there. I get you there?
Because you said the D word.
Here, I said call Doug.
I know.
About pot. I didn't say about
well,
sex
if I'm going
to
call him, it's not going to be about... Anyway, are we getting... Our time is up. We're going to come back now with Sheila Paluzzi, and she's going to... Paluzzi? That sounded wrong. But it's right. From the Healing Loft, and we're going to talk about empathy.
Empathy. Get off me!
I want to know how you feel. We'll be back on Wellness Wednesday right after this. Don't go anywhere. I'm going to feel better now.
Oh.
Sure.
Welcome back, Sheila Paluzzi from the Healing Loft. Nice to see you again.
I love coming here.
I love you on Wellness Wednesdays because having like first Judith and now you bring me an inner peace. But now we're really talking today. This is great focus. I love the issue we're talking about today. Empathy.
Yes, sir.
Describe how would you describe empathy and why is it important in our lives? That was a good question.
Absolutely. I would describe empathy, in my words, as the ability to connect with what someone else is feeling. And Teresa Wiseman did research and she broke it down into four elements. So empathy includes perspective taking. So the ability to, whether we agree or not, but the ability to take another person's perspective and put ourselves in their shoes. Eliminating judgment. Which is difficult for a lot of us to do.
Yes.
We kind of want to have our opinions and judgments. Connecting to the emotion in the other person and the emotion within us, which can be a little vulnerable and scary sometimes. And then the fourth is communicating that. Right? So communicating that I can understand maybe how you're feeling about a certain situation or why you're upset about something. And those are the four components of empathy.
What is it about being empathetic that is challenging for some people? Why do some of us put up barriers instead of trying to put ourselves in somebody else's shoes? Rather than do that, we try to fix them or we try to diminish what they're feeling sometimes. We want to put them in the grand scheme of things. It's not that important. Or what is it? Why do we do that?
There's a couple different reasons.
Okay.
One of them is, you know, when I was here last time about emotion avoidance.
Mm-hmm.
So sometimes, you know, in order for me to communicate empathy for you, I have to connect with how you're feeling. I have to connect with how I'm feeling. And if that's not something that I'm used to doing, it can, you know, just not be a skill that I've developed.
It's a place of vulnerability.
And that's the other thing.
Opening yourself up.
Yeah. It can be a little raw, right?
Mm-hmm.
To just really, really listen to something that you're sharing if it's painful, and to connect with all those emotions that come up and be able to say, like, I can understand why you feel that way because.
And then that desire to fix people, that's another approach to empathy too, right? And it's not being empathetic when you say, well, at least you don't blah, blah, blah. Like, at least you're not a starving child in Africa or you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, you need to.
That line we've all heard as kids.
Other people have it worse than you.
Yeah.
That's not really helping somebody through their issue, is it?
It's not at all. And what often it can do, and we don't intend it. So I just want to first say, when we want to fix it, or, you know, if we're trying to get someone to look at the bright side, it's
right.
Not because we don't care. It's not because we're callous or malice. I just totally lost my train of thought. Well, sorry.
No, that's okay. You were saying basically that we're not trying to be negative or downplay it. We're just trying to, it's an approach we're taking because
Well, one, we may not know like what the other person's feeling.
Yeah.
We may not want to make it worse.
Mm-hmm.
We may deeply care about somebody who's struggling. So we do want to make it better. So we might go right into that fix it mode.
Look on the bright side.
Yeah. And that is like the positive movement, right? And there's nothing wrong with gratitude practice or looking on the bright side. But if you're coming to me with something that's really difficult,
mm-hmm.
and I tell you to look on the bright side right away, are you going to want to finish talking to me?
Right? No.
And
so now you're this is about relationships, really, isn't it? I mean, this is human relationships.
100%.
And so how do you help people in the counseling sessions, in the group sessions, let's talk a little bit about how you take these workshops, these lessons, and help people in different environments, for instance. So marriages, families, and workplaces. Let's talk a little bit about that.
For sure.
How can you apply this empathetic approach to dealing with people in these different environments?
So in the family therapy that I do, what I often do is teach parents. The skill that we use is validation. So that's the expression of empathy.
Okay.
So in the family therapy model that I use, it's teaching parents how to validate their child, right?
Okay.
So that to help them, their child work through their emotions so they're not stuffing them down, which can then lead to, you know, other issues that we talked about last time. So
one thing I didn't like was, don't be a baby, you know, to smarten up.
Or if you were a sensitive child like me and had really big emotions,
yes.
And it was like, oh, you're being dramatic.
Overly dramatic. So validation, okay.
Do you ever get told that?
Oh, yes. And then you have to, and then you're pushing all that stuff down, and it sits in there, and it doesn't get, and it's like, yeah, it festers.
It does. It really does.
So validating us, just allowing them to express themselves and trying to understand what they're going through.
Yep. And help them work through their emotion. Because once emotion is worked through and we can talk about it, then that distress is gone from the body.
I can see how in a partnership with your...
With couples therapy, often using that. I mean, we don't... I don't use it in the same exact way as I do with family therapy. Mm-hmm. But teaching couples in terms of how to, like, just really listen and how to empathize with where the other person's coming from. And empathy and validation, it doesn't mean you have to agree. I mean... ask my husband. I can validate him, but most of the time I may not end up agreeing at the end of a discussion or a disagreement.
Right.
But it's just that ability to express, like, I can understand where you're coming from and I care about how you feel around this specific topic.
Yes. A lot of this is going to be based in, like, listening and breathing and allowing, right, and not knee-jerk reactions, which is so, we're so conditioned to do that.
Absolutely.
We get defensive. We want to be right.
Mm-hmm. Huh? And that's where we bring it into the corporate world.
Oh, now you move into the workplace.
Yeah.
So we were talking before the show and I was saying, I can imagine when you're dealing in, you actually bring workshops into the workplace to talk about empathy in the workplace.
Mm-hmm.
So I said, I can imagine sort of from a coworker perspective or even more so from a management perspective, you don't want to appear vulnerable. You don't want to seem weak. And sometimes being empathetic can be mistaken for being vulnerable or weak, but it isn't. It's a strength. Mm,
it's a huge strength.
So talk a little bit about how that can work in the work environment then.
So in the work environment, it's the same skill. So if you're just communicating empathy, but where it can be really helpful is, I mean, one, it brings connection.
Mm-hmm.
So even though, you know, our work colleagues are our work colleagues, we're still spending a ton of time with them.
Really?
Right? So to be able to be yourself and to be able to say how you're feeling and talk those things through, it can help with conflict management in a big way.
Absolutely.
Because there's always dynamics in the workplace, right? Where just different personalities and, you know, that kind of stuff, which is normal and okay. So to be able to just talk about, you know, things that might be frustrating people or things that are getting you down and get that empathetic response, it creates connection on teams.
Yep.
It builds trust on teams and it can de-escalate conflict really quickly because most people just want to be heard and understood.
And this is all about mental health too.
Yeah.
This is mental well-being, and everyone knows, as far as productivity in the workplace, people who are feeling good work better, and you have a better work outcome, right?
Yeah. Well, if I'm not stuffing down my frustration all day because you said something that upset me, and I'm able to approach you, and you can say, "Oh, I can see how that would have upset you," then that anger's gone. I'm not walking around for the rest of the day banging stuff and kind of slamming doors.
And as you said, you're spending so much time in that environment with these people. So I was talking about levels of intimacy in our lives. You know, on sporting teams, you spend that time, and it's a different level of intimacy. When you're in a place of worship, you have a congregation, that's a level of intimacy. And you can't deny that when you're in a workplace, there is a connection, there is a bond, there is a relationship there that is a level of intimacy that is undeniable. And you have to respect that.
Yeah.
And this,
and appreciate it.
And the approach, this empathetic approach, certainly would be conducive to that, right?
Well, I mean, people feel validated, again, like they feel the trust builds, the relationships are better.
We got to wrap up. The Healing Loft, once again, is located where, Sheila?
719 Queen Street East.
And you have a fabulous Facebook page.
Thank you. And our website's finally up.
The website is up.
It's live.
What, tell us where it is.
www.thehealingloftssm.com.
And they offer so much more than what Sheila and I are talking about today. It's worth looking into. And we're going to have you guys back on the show again for more Wellness Wednesdays. I love having you on the show.
I love coming.
Nice to see you.
So fabulous.
Happy holidays.
Yeah, same to you and everybody else.
And we'll be back to say goodbye with Luann right after this.
Oh, the weather outside is frightful, but the fire is so delightful. And since we've no place to go, let it snow, let it snow, let it snow.
And the show's already done. That woman is gorgeous.
Inside and out.
Oh my word. And then you had Judith earlier. She's gorgeous.
I know. And
then you have me.
She ruins everything.
You're my Come back tomorrow.
You're my beautiful friend.
Thank you. I love you too.
Was
Bumslide Thursday.
See you tomorrow.